trustees, with your wonderful president and faculty and members of your administration, with your families, but most importantly, I am honored to be here with what I am sure is the best graduating class in the history of Whittier College. As you leave this wonderful place, I hope you will wander off the beaten career path and help redefine success in the 21st century. Asking not how much can I get, but how much can I do without and share. Asking not how can I find myself, but rather how can I lose myself in service to others. As with Whittier, I grew up in a family where service was as an essential part of my upbringing as eating, sleeping, and going to school. Caring black adults were buffers against the segregated prison of the outside world that told me as a black girl that I wasn't important. But I didn't believe it because my parents said it wasn't so, my teacher said it wasn't so, and my preacher said it wasn't so. So the childhood message I internalized was that as God's child, no man or woman could look down on me, and I could look down on no man or woman. I couldn't play in segregated public playgrounds or sit at drugstore lunch counters, so my father, a Baptist minister, built a playground and canteen behind our church. Whenever he and my mother saw a need, they always tried to respond. There are no black homes for the aged. So my parents began one across the street, and all the right children had to cook and clean and serve. We sure didn't like it at the time, but that's how we learned that it was our responsibility to take care of elderly family members and neighbors, and that everyone was our neighbor. Black church and community members were watchful extended parents. They reported on me when I did wrong, and they applauded when I did well. And the adults in my childhood were very clear about what they valued. Doing well meant being helpful to others, achieving in school and reading. All of my siblings and I figured out very early that the only time our daddy wouldn't give us a chore was when we were reading. We were big readers. Children were taught by example that nothing was too lowly to do, and that the work of our hands and of our heads were equally important. Our families, religious congregations, communities made children feel useful and important. And while life was often hard and resources scarce, we always knew who we were, and that the measure of our worth was inside our heads and hearts and not outside in personal possessions or personal ambitions. I was taught that the world had a lot of problems, but that we could struggle and change them. That intellectual and material gifts brought the privilege and responsibility of sharing with others less fortunate, and the service is a rent each of us pays for living and not something you do in your spare time or after you've made that first million. I'm so grateful for these childhood legacies of a living faith reflected in daily service, the discipline of hard work, and a capacity to struggle in the face of adversity. Giving up was not a part of my childhood lexicon. You got up every morning, did what you had to do, and you got up every time you fell down and tried as many times as you had to until it was done right. My elders had grit. They valued family life and family rituals and tried to be and expose us to good role models. And role models were two kinds, those who had achieved in the outside world, but also those who didn't have much formal education or money, but who taught us by the very special grace of their lives what Christ and Tolstoy and Gandhi and so many others believed, and that is that the kingdom of God is within. And Walter Percy, I think, put it best when he said, you can get all A's and still want right life. And every day, I still try to be half as good as those ordinary people of grace who shared whatever they had with others. I was 14 the night my daddy died. He had holes in his shoes. He had two children, however, who graduated from college, one child in college, another in divinity school, and a vision that he conveyed to me, even dying in an ambulance, that I, as a young black girl, could be and do anything that race and gender or shadows, and that character, self-discipline, determination, attitude, and service are the substance of life. And I want to convey that same vision to you today in this graduating class. responsibility, instant gratification without effort, instant solutions without sacrifice, getting rather than giving, and hoarding rather than sharing are the two frequent signals of our mass media and popular culture living life. The standard for success for too many Americans has become personal greed rather than common good. The standard for striving and achievement has become getting by rather than making an extra effort or helping others. Truth-telling and moral example have become devalued commodities, and nowhere is the paralysis of public and private conscience more evident than in the neglect and abandonment of millions of our shrinking pool of children, whose futures will determine all of our futures and our nation's ability to compete and lead in the new era. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the great Protestant German Protestant theologian, said he died opposing Hitler's Holocaust, but he believed, as I do, that the morality of a society is how it treats its children. And after 35 years of trying to get us to pass that test, I am still ashamed to say that we flunk that test every hour of every day. A child drops out of school, and these are children of all races and income groups, every 10 seconds of the day. And how are we going to compete with the Chinese and the Indians and the Brazilians and the Russians if our children are dropping out of school every 10 seconds and a majority of all of our children are not reading at grade level in 4th, 8th, and 12th grade? This is something we must do something about. Every 33 seconds, though we've been blessed with enormous abundance, a child is born into poverty. The majority of their families are working, playing by the rules, can't earn enough to meet their children's basic needs. Every 35 seconds, a child is abused or neglected. And every 39 seconds, a child is born in this country without health insurance. And I've got one ask of all of you today. You make sure that your senators and congressmen hear that this is the year when everybody in America must have health coverage. Child has a child, and every 3 hours a child is killed by guns, eight a day. That's the equivalent of a Virginia Tech massacre every 4 days, and we let it go on and on. I don't know what it's going to take to get us to stand up and stop the killing of children. And I am deeply worried, even though we've had this transformation at the top, and I'm so proud of our nation, I'm so proud of our new president. We also have to be mindful that while we have broken through many ceilings, we have got a very dangerous backward trend, and our children are downwardly mobile, and the American dream was always about passing on to your children a better country and a better earth than you inherited. And we've got a reverse course, but the thing that I want you to get in your minds is that there is a very dangerous development, and we at the Children's Defense Fund call it the cradle-to-prison pipeline. Incarceration is becoming the new American apartheid, and you in California are leaders in this trend. You have 1 in 9 prisoners in America. We're the world's leading jailer. But a black boy today who is 8 years old has a 1 in 3 chance of going to prison in his lifetime. A Latino boy, a 1 in 6 chance. A black girl, a 1 in 17 chance. This growing incarceration with the criminalization of children at younger and younger ages, we've got to see it, we've got to name it, we've got to tear down that prison pipeline, and we've got to replace it. The pipeline, the college, and to productive work so that every child has a level playing field for good. Must do it. I think we have lost our sense of what is important as a people. But too many of our young people of all races and classes are growing up unable to handle life in hard places without hope, steady compasses to navigate a world that is reinventing itself at an unpredictable pace. Technologically, economically, and politically. My generation learned that to accomplish anything, we had to get off the dime. Your generation must learn to get off the paradigm over and over and have to be very flexible, quick, and smart about it. But despite all of this dazzling change, I think there are still some enduring values, and you've heard them here at Whittier. I'm sure you've heard them in your families. But I'm going to give you a few of them today, and like my own children, you can take them or leave them. But I do want, as you go out into the world, to remind you first that there is no free lunch in life. Don't feel feel entitled to anything you don't sweat and struggle for. And you help our nation. And let's help our nation understand that it's not entitled to world leadership based on the past or on what we say rather than how well we perform and meet changing world needs. And if there are any graduates in this class who feel entitled to leadership by accident of birth, let me remind you the world you face, and I love looking out at this diverse class, is already two-thirds non-white and poor, and that our nation is becoming a mosaic of greater diversity that you're going to have to understand, respect, and work with and lead. But I think you've gotten such a good start here at Quiddian. Don't for a moment think you've got it made. Your Quiddian degree may get you in the door, but it won't get you to the top of the career ladder and it won't keep you there. You've got to work your way up hard and continuous. I know I don't have to say this, but don't you ever be lazy. Do your homework. Pay attention to detail. Take care and pride in your work. Take the initiative in creating your own opportunity and don't wait around for other people to discover you or to do you a favor. Don't assume a door is closed. Push on it. And don't assume if it was closed yesterday that it's still closed today. Push on it again. Keep pushing on those doors. Don't assume that if you ever can sort of get your next degrees that you can stop learning. Don't ever stop learning and improving your mind, because if you do, you and America are going to be left behind. Second, make sure that you set thoughtful goals, as I'm sure you've learned here at Quiddian, and work quietly and systematically towards achieving them. Don't feel you have to talk if you don't have anything worth saying. Resist quick fix, simplistic answers and easy games that often disappear just as quickly as they come. So many people talk big and act small. So often we get bogged down in our ego needs and lose sight of deeper needs. It's okay to want to feel important, but it's not okay if it's at the expense of doing important deeds. Even if you don't get the credit, and I learned early on in Washington particularly that you can get a lot achieved in life if you don't mind doing the work and letting other people take the credit. You know what you do, and the Lord knows what you do, and that's all that should matter. Third, assign yourself. My dad used to always ask us when we came home from work, from school, and the teacher gave us any homework, and if we say no, he said, well, assign yourself some. If you see a need, don't ask why doesn't somebody do something. You ask why don't I do something. And I still believe that hard work, initiative, persistence are still the non-magic carpets to success for most of us. Fourth, please don't ever work just for money. Money alone won't save your soul and won't build a decent family or help you sleep at night. We're the richest nation on earth with one of the highest, with the highest incarceration and one of the highest drug addiction and child poverty rates in the world. Don't confuse wealth or fame with character. And don't tolerate or condone moral corruption, whether it's found in high or low places, whatever its color or class. It is not okay to push or use drugs, even if everybody in America is doing it. It is not okay to lie or to cheat. Be honest and demand that those who represent you be honest, and don't ever confuse legality with morality. Dr. King once noted that everything that Hitler did in Nazi Germany was legal, but it wasn't right. Don't give anybody the proxy for your conscience. Fifth, don't be afraid of taking risks or being criticized. You don't want to be criticized. Don't say anything, don't do anything, and don't be anything. Sixth, please, for those of you who want to form families and have children, take parenting and family life seriously. Plan as arduously for how you're going to manage a wonderful family and children, if that's what you choose to do, as you do for your career. And children need fathers and mothers. And let's talk about how we can have shared parenting responsibility in this new era. Seven, don't fail to listen to the genuine within yourself. I sent my children to Quaker schools in high school, and I think that notion of silence and being able to be with yourself, so important. Small, Einstein said, there's a number of them that see with their own eyes and feel with their own hearts, and I hope each of you will try to be one of them. There is, Howard Thurman, the black theologian, says, something in every one of us that waits and listens for the sound of the genuine in ourselves, and it is the only true guide you'll ever have. And if you cannot hear it, you will all of your life spend your days on the ends of strings that somebody else pulls. There's so many noises and so many competing demands in our lives that many of us never find out who we are. Learn how to continue your silence and to be quiet within yourself so that you can hear the sound of the genuine within yourself and then be able to hear it in other people. And I'm about done. Last lesson. Never think life is not worth living and you cannot make a difference. Never, ever give up. I don't care how hard it gets. It's going to get very hard sometimes. There's an old proverb that says, when you get to your wit's end, that's where God lives. Harriet Beecher Stowe said that when you get into a tight place and everything goes against you, when it seems as if you could not hang on for another minute, never give up then. But that is just the time and the place that the tide will turn. Hang in with life. And don't think you have to win immediately or even at all to make a difference. Sometimes it's important to lose for things that matter. Don't think you have to be a big dog to make a difference. My role model is Sojourner Truth, who was a brilliant but illiterate slave woman. And in the hopeless era when nobody thought that women were equal and certainly that slavery could be ended, she never gave up speaking against both. And one day she was speaking out against slavery and she got heckled by a white man who stood up in the audience and said to her, old slave woman, don't care any more about your anti-slavery talk than for an old flea bite. And she snapped back at him and said, that's all right, the Lord willing, I'm going to keep you scratching. What we have to do, but we need big changes and we need transformation of our global and national priorities. But each of us, we don't need to be big dogs, we need to be strategic, persistent fleas. Enough fleas for justice can make the biggest dog uncomfortable. And enough people exercising their votes, their calls, their emails to their senators and their congressmen right now in the next few months can get health care for every American. Your voice matters. Please use it. Be a strategic flea for poor children who don't have a voice, for those who don't have health care, for those who need you. Democracy, as you've heard over and over again, is not a spectator sport. Let me give Shel Silverstein the last word, the children's book writer. He said, listen to the mustn'ts, child. Listen to the don'ts. Listen to the shouldn'ts, the impossibles, the won'ts. Listen to the never haves, then listen close to me. Anything can happen, child. Anything can be. If you dream it, if you believe in it, if you have faith in it, if you struggle for it, if you never give up, never give up. Godspeed to all of you.
Thank you so much. Our newest member of the